Rev up your engines. Today I'm going to be talking about the most dangerous car to be driving in America today and about car safety in general. And the winner is, drum roll please, or should I say the loser, the 2006 Kia Spectra. Danger in terms of vehicle deaths in the United States goes by a system that's called deaths per million registered vehicle miles. And the Kia is at the top of the list, the 2006 Kia Spectra, because it's got 191 deaths in the system. Now, to compare that to my wife's 2002 Lexus ES300, this only has 12 deaths per million registered vehicle miles. So this thing is like 16 times safer than the Kia is. Statistically, you're 16 times less likely to die in this Lexus than you are in the Kia. And that is kind of interesting because this Lexus is way faster than the Kia. You think people be going super fast and get killed in high speed wrecks where the Kia can't go that fast, but no, that's not the case. Now, the Nissan 350Z does have a high rate. There are 143 deaths per million registered vehicle miles. But hey, it's a sports car. People drive them fast. The vehicle itself is relatively well made, but when you're driving like maniacs, especially younger male drivers, there's going to be more people killed just because of the nature of the beast. But it's still below that of the Kia Spectra. Now, of course, some of this death has to do with the size of the vehicle. That's kind of obvious. For example, you're about 100 times more likely to die in a tiny Chevy Aveo than you are in a Toyota Sienna minivan. That just makes sense. Size does have a lot to do with it, and here's a little history of seat restraint systems to explain why. Now, when I was a young mechanic in the 1960s, there were a lot of 1950s cars still rolling around. They didn't even have seat belts in them. It was an option for some, and some didn't even have the ability to have. You'd have to put them in yourself. Then they came out with simple lap belts, like in an airplane, where it just buckles over your waist. And that, of course, kept people from flying through the windshields and being thrown out of the car. Hey, in the 1950s and earlier, you get in a big wreck, you actually would fly right through the windshield. One of my father's customers was a black and white photographer for accidents. And he had these pictures in the 1950s of people with their heads cut off flying through the windshields. I mean, it's pretty gruesome stuff. The seat belts were definitely a radical change that was needed for the car driving public. And in 1959, Volvo was the first company to use mass-produced three-point seat belts like some of the modern systems are. It was actually an American patent in 1955, but the Swedes were the first one to produce it because, I guess Americans had this thing that they don't like being restrained in their car. They want to still pretend they're on the couch in the living room watching TV instead of driving. My old Celica has that system. It goes over your lap and your shoulder. And it's actually a pretty good system as long as you use it. But still, many Americans, they wanted to feel they were on a living room couch and they wouldn't use the things. So they came up with the idea of airbags. Airbags are completely passive. They're not active at all. All you have to do is sit in the car. The airbag's built into here. And there's another one built into here. And many modern cars have side airbags, curtain airbags, airbags all over the place. Airbags work by themselves. There's sensors on the car. You get in a wreck, there's an actual explosive device. The airbag explodes, and this canvas bag absorbs all your energy of going forwards or sideways if there are airbags on the side. And they do work great, but they got one problem. They inflate really fast in microseconds. They hold you in and they deflate. So they only work one time. Let's say you're in a small car, you get hit. The airbags deploy great. But what happens if then you roll over, another car hits you, or you fly over a ravine or something? They're not gonna work like a seatbelt that's a permanent thing holding you in place. Plus, you're believing that this complex computer-driven system is gonna sit there for maybe 10, 12 years, and then all of a sudden, the one time it's needed, it's gonna activate correctly. I've had customers in Chrysler vans be driving down the road when they're older, hit a bump, and the airbags went off in their face. They almost got in a wreck because of the airbags. And I've also had customers that have been in cars where they got in a wreck, and the airbags just didn't deploy. Now, conventional three-point seat belts, hey, they click in place. Pretty simple latch. If you use them,
They are a great safety device.
But even with them, size does matter in a car. This Lexus is a pretty big, hefty car. Get in a Kia Spectra, or maybe even worse for size, a smart car. And you'll see, there's not that much space between you and the car. And if you get hit by a big 18-wheeler or a big Ford F-150 truck, the odds are you're not gonna do too good inside those. Even though they claim they have structure that's gonna save you, there just isn't enough structure. Now, modern cars are designed with crumple zones quite well, so that when you get in a wreck, instead of you getting crushed, the energy is absorbed by the car crumpling itself in. But when you got a tiny little car, there's only so much to crumple. A bigger car's got a lot of crumple space before it's gonna get to you. And modern collision avoidance systems that they have in the newer cars, yeah, they work to some extent to help you from hitting things if you don't see somebody not running into them. But hey, if somebody's coming piling to you from the front or the side, they're not going to save you. Only size and good seat belts are going to save you in that case. So now you know what the most dangerous car to drive in America today is and how to avoid becoming one of its victims. So if you never want to miss another one of my new car repair videos, remember to ring that bell.